When I first did Star Wars, I did it as a big piece. It was like a big script. It was way too big to make into a movie. So I took the first third of it, which was basically the first act, and I turned that into what was the original Star Wars. In the process of rewriting that script and thinking of it as only a movie and not the whole, trilogy, I decided that Ben Kenobi really didn't serve any useful function after the point he fights with Darth Vader. Although in that draft, he continued on through the air battle at the end, and then he continued on through the whole script, the other two stories. And but when I took one and I looked at it, I said, he just stands around for the last 25% of the film, watching his air battle go on. And he really has no real function, and it would probably be much more satisfying, powerful, and interesting if Darth Vader were to kill him, or he were to go into a different form. I made that decision based on just working on Star Wars. After Star Wars was successful, and I said, well, gee, I could finish this entire script, I could do the other two parts. I came to certain realizations about things that were in the script that were more difficult to now translate. Another one was the Wookiee. In the end of the film, it takes place on a Wookiee planet, and there's a big battle with the Empire and the Wookiees and that sort of thing. Since I couldn't do that, I took one of the Wookiees and made him a co-pilot with Harrison. But in the original concept, the Wookiees were a primitive tribe. That was sort of key to what was going on at the end of the film. And then when I put Chewbacca in as a co-pilot, I've kind of established them as a fairly sophisticated race. And so then when I went back, I couldn't use the Wookiees, so I turned them into Ewoks. So in the case of Ben Kenobi, I had Luke being trained by Ben, only I had killed Ben off. So now I had to come up with another Jedi who was older and wiser and shorter than Ben to train Luke, and that's how that was the beginning premise of Yoda. Fairly early on, that the idea of a space dogfight came into play, of wouldn't it be interesting to take that kind of visual excitement and put it into outer space? So it was written, I think, very early on. It's in almost all the drafts of the screenplay. And in order to, I had no idea at that point how I was going to accomplish it. So it really wasn't until I sat down to figure it out and got together with some of the people who I brought in to start ILM that we began to focus on the fact that we would have to create a different technology in order to accomplish that. The approach that I had, which is to do it editorially rather than pictorially, I think I had from the very beginning, because it seemed inconceivable that I could actually do what Kubrick had done in 2001, and have it be done for any kind of amount of money that I would have access to. So I figured I would, do it by sleight of hand, using a lot of editorial techniques. And so I had to create something that was in motion. And we did what we call videomatics, which we'd take little models and move them around on video and transfer that. And we did do some little animated pieces with very crude animation. And then I took, footage from actual dogfights that, we got out of gun cameras in World War I and World War II and various documentaries and that sort of thing. And out of that created a sequence that is more visual in motion. I wanted a sort of a slick used car dealer voice, and tried everything I could to get another actor to come up to the performances that Tony had, and I just couldn't find anybody to do it. And that was one of the reasons why I ended up with James Earl Jones as Darth Vader, because it really takes the top class actor to pull off that kind of an idea, to really be able to get into a part where you're just putting your voice over a an animated character, or, you know, in this case, it's not even an animated character, because it's a character that's already been shot. So it's the reverse of what you get to do in animation. In animation, you get to sort of act it and create it. In this one, you're sort of working within the confines of what somebody else has already created. You know, the movement and the timing and all that sort of thing has been determined for you. And to be able to come up with a really excellent performance, given that if you're not the one that's actually doing it, it's extremely difficult. He started out in American Graffiti, and then I used him as a foil to do tests in Star Wars. I didn't actually interview him for Star Wars. He was brought in to do, you know, play against the other actors. You know, I had all these Lukes coming in, and so he would play against them, and I shot the screen test. And, you know, when you watch the screen tests of him playing the role and the other actors who were up for the role playing the role, there was just no question about who was the best. And, you know, so I hired him for Star Wars. I was looking for a princess who was young. Ideally, I wanted somebody about 16 years old, 17 years old. They, both Luke and Leia were supposed to be around the same age, and I wanted somebody, you know, teenager-like. So it was finding somebody who could hold her own against strong actors and, you know, and still be the princess that she needed to be and be the authority figure that she needed to be and make it believable. And she was able to do that. And again, you know, with these actors, all of them, you know, I tested, I'd seen thousands of people, tested, you know, 20 or 30 people, and then gone down to on tape. And then gone to a very finite group of, you know, maybe seven or eight actors for each role on film, and then studied it, and then we did that process again. So it was a very complicated procedure that took like 9 months to go through. So it wasn't just a that's the one kind of thing. It was a very arduous, thoughtful process.
George talked about Star Wars, and he didn't have a title yet, but the concept for a film that was going to be a big galactic war. Then when he started to talk to Fox, it seemed to him a good idea to have some illustrations to show the scope of the visuals that he'd planned, which I think in George's mind was a big part of the movie. And I told him that I'd love to do it. He and Gary came over one day with the script. I started on it the same day. I really got into it right away, working on those original paintings that were really done to sell the film. George and Gary went off, left me doing more paintings. Fox wanted me to do more paintings. Gary and George went to England and started scouting this whole thing from a budget point of view. Came back 3 or 4 weeks later saying, looks like they're going to do this film. I never really thought it would be a film while I was working on those original paintings. It seemed so vast a project to me. There was quite a few things set up by George, and I felt I was drawing what he wanted things to look like. I don't think that either of us thought that's the way the movie was going to look, necessarily. These were just sketches that were the best we could do in terms of how we felt it should look, but not necessarily the end product, in the sense that this was really going to be it. But it sort of turned out to be it in the end, for the most part. And some of those paintings were virtually rendered intact onto the screen in Star Wars for certain scenes.